Welcome to part 4 of our developer playthrough of Portal Stories Mill. We continue where we left off. It's a few days later that we record this.
Yes, the mod is actually released now.
Yeah, it's been quite a while already, like 2 weeks almost?
Yes, it'll be 2 weeks tomorrow. That went by quickly.
Yeah, it did.
So, this puzzle was created by Chris, isn't it? Yeah.
Yes.
And, I think I just did a bit of, I re-detailed the ceiling, because it wasn't that great. I did some more detailing stuff in here, but it's Chris's puzzle.
And originally these were higher up, and we found that it was really confusing, gameplay-wise, so we decided to change it up. And there is something really funny going on here. There is a weird bug where this funnel can throw you out. And we've tried everything to fix it. But it continues to happen, and it's just some weird bug with the funnel. This also used to happen in concepts, but for some reason...
It can still happen, but it's a lot rarer. I don't know, maybe Valve tried to fix funnels and broke it more or something.
Yeah, but we actually completely cheated it, and we can show you what we did. There's actually secretly here where the funnel is. You can see this trigger. If you would fall down here instead, it will pick you up and push you back into the funnel. So if that happens to you, you'll automatically be solved. You will automatically be caught by the security system.
Yeah, to prevent an unfair death, basically, due to a glitch.
Yeah.
We tried everything possible to fix, like, deleting and remaking everything, and we literally couldn't find the solution, so that was the best thing to do. But surprisingly, for such a small puzzle, I've actually seen a lot of people have a lot of difficulty with this. Like, it's a very small, very simple puzzle, and, like, some people can get stumped in this for ages.
Yeah.
Hey, Mel. Yeah, this is a little, tiny, like, connecting room that I... put a nice protective texture in. This puzzle was a combination of mine and your ideas on it.
Yes.
Which actually gets referenced later on as the two particularly cruel scientists, which is both of us. It is quite a tricky puzzle. Like, it sort of it uses stuff that you learned in concepts, like portaling something when it's on the floor.
Yeah, like in the intended way, you leave the cube over here, and then you go through the funnel, and then you leave one portal here, shoot under there, and walk over here, behind this fizzler here, then portal the cube there, and then portal yourself out again. And, like, that's a technique, the put portal under here, is what you do in concepts, and we've seen a lot of people struggle with it in concepts as well. It's the very first run in Concepts. Concepts, by the way, is the first map in the clean theme.
Well, it's the version of the clean theme that I came up with where it's like half finished.
Yep.
The clean theme itself, by default, is really boring. But just, this map's originally was like we concepted it in PTI, then obviously we rebuilt it in Hammer because exporting from the PTI is absolutely awful because it's just horrible blocks. So it was rebuilt, and then I did the detailing in this, and I think of all the Overgrown maps that I detailed, like, this is my favourite one. I think it worked pretty well.
Yeah, it looks absolutely gorgeous, and this is a really amazing detail.
Yeah, I put in, like, a broken elevator thing. We originally actually wanted that to be part of the elevator that you come up at the end of the game, but the slant obviously caused a lot of issues, and one of the fun facts is this chamber is lit by a flickering protective texture coming from an elevator that's just hanging in the ceiling. And it was Camman, I think, made skins for us, or someone made skins for the elevator, like a dirty version, like that I pointed out before, and also has an on and off version of the light.
Yes.
But we did know about an awful lot of like solutions to a lot of the chambers, but you know, we kept them in, we had Zernica's like playtesting quite a bit at the start, and like he did some really, really cool stuff, but like they were so difficult to pull off that like we kept them in, and like we do love, you know, having alternate solutions. Like we have our, you know, quote unquote intended way, but like, we didn't think there was any reason like to punish players for doing it in unusual ways, unless the puzzle was completely and utterly broken, which we have yet to see so far.
Yeah, like we're okay with, like, as long as once you solve the puzzle, you feel that you've actually solved the puzzle, it's fine. Like, there is a solution we know where you can portal into this observation room with this funnel, and then funnel yourself.
Yeah, but like, things like this, this rewards your, like, ingenuity. Like, for example, there's that map in Portal 1 where, like, you completely skip the entire chamber by doing one fling, and Valve kept that in because they thought, like, players who understood the mechanics well enough to do this, like, deserve to be able to skip the entire chamber. And it's sort of something similar, like, if you can do cool stuff with the mechanics, then obviously, like, you know, it means that you're outsmarting the puzzle, sort of, but, like, as we do know about that, quite a few puzzles have alternate solutions.
Yeah, that was the joke, by the way, about the particular cruel scientists, that's the two of us. over here, once again, like, you have this panel, which you can use for the laser, or you can use the laser cube. Originally, you had to do this entire step again, to get up there, so we decided to go with two possibilities where it didn't really matter which cube you used. We have the laser cube over there. You could also have the laser cube here, and then you don't need to use the panel. It's, like, you can choose, it's either way, it's fine.
Yeah, and basically, it doesn't punish you then if you use, like, quote unquote, the wrong cube. It means you can solve it either way.
Yeah, and, like, as I said, like, originally you had to come up here again, and then I believe, like, there was a button or something to disable this. But, like, once you solve this once, like, that's good enough. Like, you can just portal in here. And, yeah, that way we added some, quote unquote shortcuts, I guess. So it's not as tenacious that you have to do things over and over again. And then we load up into To the Kind.
Oh yeah. This map. This was the very first map I made when I joined the Portal Stories team, like 2.5 years ago now, or if not about 3 by now. This was the very first one I made. In fact, it used to have blue gel in it at one point, which is why there's like a bit of a space. And I guess this part was like that random like pipes. That's where the blue gel dropper used to be, and I just sort of filled it in a bit. But yeah, so this is my oldest puzzle, like the very first thing that I did. And obviously I did the detailing for it as well. And yeah, this puzzle has stumped a lot of people, and I think it's for a clever reason. It's because the entire premise of it involves around doing the same thing twice, and like most people think, you know, they're not progressing because they have to go back, and then they therefore think they're doing the wrong thing. But the thing is, like, you have to go back to go forward, basically. And like, if you do the same thing twice when you go back, you know, you've got the extra option of the orange funnel. So like, you have to float yourself all the way over and then get the orange funnel started, and then do the exact same thing to float all the way over again. And like, it feels counterintuitive, which is one of the reasons why it makes it so difficult. And like, this is one of those puzzles where like, if you love challenging, like, it's a very, very simple puzzle. And like, I mean, there's nothing complex or fast ninja speed required in it. But like, I've seen a lot of people like particularly like it because it really, really made them think. But also a lot of people that were that hate it because it's very, very tricky and involves sort of quite outside the box thinking. And
yeah, because, like, you now spend time to get into this funnel again.
Yeah, you're doing the exact same thing you just did.
Yeah, and, like, it's like, hey, but why would this make any progress? Well, you just activated that orange funnel, and then you can funnel yourself back. And this is also really cool to notice. The BTS in here will come back later on.
Yes, this exact BTS, and then there's, like, a lift, like, that's blocked up with some pipes. That is actually the lift we use in the very final cutscene. Well, like, for the SFM shot, like, so you actually come back up through to the kind again.
Yeah, and, like, in the original version, like, in patch one, like, the release date patch, there was a white surface over here, which was part of, like, this test has also gone through several iterations. And originally you require that,
and that was for blue gel.
Yeah, that was for blue gel indeed. And like, That was really confusing for a lot of people, so we decided to get rid of that white surface on the ceiling here to prevent confusion.
Because it was just a single white surface on the ceiling, and it seemed like so important, and people would waste ages like thinking it was important. Although people also used it for a cheat, so the people who like you can like toss the game or something weird, and like they'll probably be disappointed. But it was because people were getting confused to the actual solution and stuff, so we limited the surfaces. Oh, and also the previous room also has a pretty funny Easter egg in it, if you find it.
Yes.
Reveals a lot about Virgil's character.
Yes. I think this is one of the latest puzzles in the mod.
Yeah, I think this might have been one of the last. I built this one and it started out completely differently. Like, the layout of the room is the exact same, pretty much, bar like, I had to change some areas into just being detail areas because they're no longer of any function. But like, I basically
the
built.
Completely yeah,
the puzzle that was originally in this map was absolutely awful. Like, I was trying to go up with a double light bridge puzzle, and it just ended up being terrible.
Yeah, for example, you have this section here that used to be important.
Yeah, you used to do this thing where you put a cube in and then swapped it, and
it just
wasn't fun at all. Yeah, it wasn't fun either. So I somehow kept the layout of the room, because I'd done already did like a lot of detailing, and like, I think I made a decent puzzle out of it. And like this fling mechanic here, flinging with a light bridge, is also from my dilapidation series. I thought it was a pretty clever kind of trick, but...
Yeah. And like, once... Oh, whoops. I accidentally skipped a step. Whoops.
Even at this point, like, we still can't solve all of the puzzles, like, instantly.
We know how to solve it, but like, just...
Yeah. Sometimes you forget a few things.
Like, most of these maps we've played, like, countless times.
Too many times. But there's a lot of detail in this room and stuff. Like,
yeah, it's...
I've made lots of little cutaway sections. And, like, if you want to look in, you can see little sneaks behind the scenes areas and stairways and catwalks above you and stuff, but...
This is also something we fixed.
Yes,
you used
yes,
to be able to shoot portal onto the ceiling accidentally.
Yeah.
Whoops. And this is a particularly nice thing, where you have all these slanted walkways going up, and you can actually also see it from up here still.
I always like having like little sneak peeks into BTS areas.
Yeah, it's also really funny because Lonewolf made this, and I was like, I totally want to do something with slanted stairs, and like. Not even a day later, he came up with an area for an Easter egg in Old Aperture, where he also uses the slanted walkway idea. And he's...
Oh, right above you, like right here, is like a little thingy as well, it's like catwalks and stuff.
Yes.
But yeah, so I just like adding lots of these little kind of areas. I mean, most people probably won't even notice them, but they kind of add to the flavor. Like, you know, you're getting these little peaks into, like, how cramped and stuff it is, that like the walkways are all around the place for getting around.
And this kind of comes back like from the fifth light level, where you also like have to do various steps and then retrieve cubes in the correct order.
Yeah, also forgot to point out earlier, but again, as sort of the concepts training, where to get the cube past the light bridge, you like fired at the ground and then you went behind and stood on the button and stuff to get the cube through.
Oh. And at some point, this office had a companion cube in it.
Yeah, we took it out though. We've only got one companion cube in the mod now. Well, there's some that are just flying through the tubes, but like, there's only one that's actually sort of there. Like, grabbable as an achievement.
Yeah. We wanted to keep it special and, like, not just shove it in your face.
Yeah, I didn't want to overdo it.
So, here we are in Destroyed already. I always, for some reason, think there's another overground map. It's, like, I know it's not the case, but. For some reason, I always expect another one to be here.
There's a little detail area near the cube dropper there that, like, almost ended up being in the trailer just because Harry liked it so much. It's just like a little area of steps that I made, and we also copied and pasted it into the next map, actually. Yeah, but you're seeing it from a different angle.
Yeah, you'll see it from that door-ish. Like, it's slightly different, but, like, we copied it over.
Yeah, I tweaked a few details, but, like, I don't think anyone would really notice unless I pointed it out. Like, this puzzle is so confusing. The indicator lights are pretty horrible.
Yeah, it's really, really hard to do that correctly. In hindsight, it might have been better to stick with the normal laser field and fissures overlapping. But that looks ugly.
I mean, it is a very clever puzzle, but yeah, I'd say probably this is one of my least favourite in the mod. Just because it's kind of confusing and you almost feel like you solve it accidentally. And then this puzzle's also been through so many changes. There used to be like a blue gel on this map too, and like an old turret and stuff. I think they got rid of all the gel from the Overgrown Chambers just because it was pretty horrible.
Yeah, it's funny to see how in Acts 3 and 4 we have a lot of funnels, because they're like funnels. They have some interesting mechanics.
Yeah, this is the most clever move here, like moving the cube off and then putting it back on again.
Yeah, and like you see these light bridges that like hit the come out of the ceiling and hit the button, and like it seems really pointless at first, but it's a really clever trick to stop the funnels on the button, and it's something I learned from one of Mevius's maps back in the day. Together with Mevius and Zivi7, I made Aperture Halloween, and that also had a puzzle where pushing the cube against the light bridge was a required step. I just shot the wrong portal, didn't I? I did.
Oh, if we go back a sec, you'll see that there's a pretty important detail because it's quite difficult to see up at the top that you need a cube. So I put a light directly above it and a pretty visible sign, an indicator-like sign, so that you can see that you need to bring a cube up. So once you go through here, you'll be able to see, like, it's right there. It's like, there's a light above it and a sign that shows you there's a cube button here. So you don't go up and be like, think you've solved it, and then get disappointed because there's a button like there.
Yeah. And this is also a really nice BTS area.
Yeah, that was salvaged from the original, which was had a really weird layout, and like a lift and all you get on. Like,
oh my goodness.
It was really strange. But then we kind of ran out of space. It's a bit cramped up here, because this is actually coming round onto the lift again and stuff, and then the map next to it, and like, it was very...
I can actually sneakily noclip out of the level to show you the layout here. Like, it's really, really close indeed to the lift. And like, as developer, you have like pretty much your entire keyboard bound to cheats, because it's very helpful in testing things.
Yeah, this is another puzzle. Like, I think this puzzle is like very, very old as well, but yeah, this is like probably, if Divakind was the hardest puzzle, this would be the second hardest. Like, I've seen people get stumped on this, and it involves sort of a similar principle, but like in the fact that you have to respawn a cube at the end, but there's nothing about doing the same thing twice.
Yeah, like this puzzle was made by iWork95, and first time I played it, like this is how far I've gotten, and like I literally got stumped for like 20 minutes straight. It's like there is something I'm missing. And
yeah, what's lovely about it is it's such a small room. It's tiny, and there's like so few elements, and yet it's got such a clever and tricky puzzle in such a tiny space.
Yeah, and this is the solution. And this, I really, really love this cube dropper from the side.
It was a pain though, there's a lot of issues with it.
Yeah, like, this is probably one of the hardest things, logic-wise, to set up. I think, like, after the transition level, where the level changes three times, it was incredibly confusing too. But this was also incredibly hard because you can like push this back in and then not, and it's really, really tricky. But it seems to work, and yeah. It looks really cool.
This chamber is the broken one. From there on, you'll have to move fast because that's the last chamber with plants in it.
So now we kind of come to the end of the, like, the game. Well, to the puzzles, and like now you have a few levels that are more designed to build towards the finale.
Yeah, they're like, very story focused and like more environmental puzzles. Like, that's the last like proper puzzle chamber. Although you could count this one, which is a completely optional test chamber.
Yes, I'll just reduce the volume a little bit further. Yeah, this test chamber is completely optional. I've seen pretty much everyone try to solve this, and there's various things, various ways to solve this. You know, it's a really broken test, like you can shoot through here and stuff, which you normally wouldn't be able to, but... yeah, that's not what, like, where you have to go. You actually have to go outside of the level here.
And if you go to your left, you'll see the little detail area again from Destroyed, but from a different angle. And I replaced the props and the pneumatic pipes and stuff.
You
hate me for that broken corridor there because of the vis leaves it makes. Like, we couldn't very easily make it neat.
It messes with this room as well, and it's really, really confusing, and some really bad lighting. Also, some no draw. Whoops. Oh well. This is the Cube Factory. And this was created by Tmast. Ooh, look, Virgil.
I don't think I've seen a single person who actually sees him. Like, I had to spend ages animating him and, like, setting up really complicated path tracks so that the player... because, like, it's to do with, like, he starts forward in certain places, but, like, I didn't want him to be, like, talking, and, like, it's kind of confusing, and, like, I had to set up, like, relays where if he went too fast that he would still move and stuff, and it was a massive pain to do, and yet most people don't even see him.
Yeah, so this is the cube testing thing. I think it looks really, really awesome.
Yeah.
And, like, we wanted to, like... show you that, like, it was like the factory was kind of offline when you enter here and then you power stuff up.
Also, that was a nice protected texture. I did do, but I think I had to re-detail this whole section. If you look up, did like some funny stuff with like beams and stuff, which sort of becomes the style for this area. Like, yeah, I wanted something that looked sort of quite intimidating with, like, huge, like, beams and angled plastic surfaces and stuff.
No. Oh. Hello, Virgil. And, like, over here you can see, like, parts of the cubes and, like, not completely working cubes yet.
And we have the turret shooting bit, and again, I had to re-detail. This used to be, like, just a big square room. And then, like, I completely and utterly redesigned this entire section to make it interesting. And, yeah, the turret will actually blow up the sparking cubes, and you get a couple of different lines from Virgil. And I think it's just, what is it, like, 33% of the cubes are broken, or...?
Yeah, 1 in 3, I think. And, like, I've literally seen people, like, get, like, 4 in a row, or, like, never get any. But we actually cheated, and, like... pretty much the second cube you'll ever see in this room will explode. Like, we set up logic to do that, pretty much. So, there's always a high chance you actually notice it.
And before you go up the stairs here, you'll see Virgil, and I made him do a little flip thing. Which, he's like, that's up those stairs, but like, most people always sprint past him and never even see it. And there's a couple of targets here too, so Virgil kind of looks like he's not always staring at you, like... sometimes he's looking at, like, the cubes being blown up and stuff. Then he goes off on his own little reel.
Yep.
And these offices coming up went through a huge redesign.
Yes, I completely redesigned these offices.
And as usual, they were lovely and clean before I came in and smashed them apart.
Yeah, like, we really like you to, like, explore areas, and, like, there's all kinds of stuff you can see here, and, like,
I hate that portal surface, though. It's so unreceptive to portals half the time.
Yeah,
I've seen people who think it's not actually a surface.
But yeah, like, there's all kinds of cool stuff to look at. For example, here are the big asbestos...
Yeah, the prototype asbestos cube.
Yeah, like, it's really big, and, like, it has a hole in it, and came from the ceiling and stuff. It's really, really good. Like, there's a lot of things, like, you can see and explore, and, like,
There's a little break room in here as well.
Yeah, the canteens. And, like, if you want, you can explore it. If you don't want it, you can just continue. And, like, originally it was a huge stretch of offices and, like...
It's all linear as well.
Yeah.
And, yeah, this is, like, a really cool room that you made.
Yes, this is... I think this looks pretty good. Yeah, this is just, like, you have this section where the turrets get built in Portal 2, and, like, we want to do it with cubes.
Yeah, in fact, the panel things that are moving with, like, the cutout things, very descriptive, they are actually the ones that were originally the turrets are just re-bump map, because they're actually just completely flat textures with just a really, really deep bump map. And I realized when I looked at them that if you look, there's only, like, one square bit on it, so which means that you'd need six to make a single cube. So six of these giant panels to make one single cube, which we actually incorporated into a little chunk.
Yeah, and, like, this puzzle came, like, from the idea. It was actually originally slightly different, but where you had to, like, walk over a walkway and then dodge these things, and, like, we wanted to make it somewhat challenging, but not super hard, so...
You can also just crouch walk the whole way.
Yeah, like, you can just crouch under these guys and almost hit your head, but not completely.
Yeah, I had to add trigger hurts, because originally they didn't have them, and then you could get jammed in all sorts of ways. In fact, to stop you from cheating and jumping over the catwalk, there were some invisible walls, and you could jump and wedge yourself in an invisible wall and be stuck forever, so
yeah,
it was
like
pretty
bad. This is really tricky, because, like, there's so many closed-off areas, and, like, we want to force you over this guy, so, like, we have to close off stuff, so there's an incredible amount of invisible walls here. Like, I think there's, like, pretty much more invisible walls in this section of the level than, like, in the entirety of the mod together.
And I think one of the cruelest things that you did is at the sides of the conveyor belt, there's actually little trigger pushes that shove you off.
Yeah, but you can actually still walk over the sides if you, like, really walk into it. But yeah, like, the idea is that, like, if you're here, like, you just get slightly pushed off, nudged off.
You don't actually need to take a cube with you, by the way.
No.
And there's another funny thing here, is these, like, panels go in through here. Now, there's actually trigger hurts on the panels, which I parented to them, obviously, to kill the player, because the, like, on-block thing wasn't really working correctly. Like, it was doing too much damage, just instantly killing the player, whereas I wanted to sort of, like, you can take about 3 hits, I think, before it'll kill you, so that way you can actually get, you know, hit, and it'll just sort of shove you back. But I parented to the wrong thing initially, and as you can see, the panel, like, claw things come through here, and was parented to those, which meant as you walk through here, you would get whacked over the head by invisible plates, which were the trigger hurts hitting you.
Oh, yeah, that was really funny. Like, they dropped them off to machines here, and then, like, you know, over here you only have the claws, and then, ugh, you get hit by invisible things. Yay.
Well, I fixed that by parenting it to the panels, which drop.
Yeah.
And yes, now we're on to my little section, and, like, me and you discussed this, and put, like, and then obviously I came up with this, like, for it, but we wanted it to be very clear that this is, like, a separate section, that's the whole, like, bridge and stuff, and if you look to the sides, you can see, like, it goes around the corner and stuff like that, and I wanted it to be very clear that this is, like, a different sort of part of Aperture, like, you're leaving the Cube Factory and going to this sort of unusually new place, and, like, here we have the first, I think it's the first sighting of the A logo that I made for ages.
Yeah, I think so.
And of course this area, very heavily inspired by the dark area in Portal 2, because protective textures are awesome, and you get like these like really nice shadows and it's really creepy sort of atmosphere and stuff.
Yeah, and
it just sort of slows you down.
And it's really well done. Like, he always points his light into the direction where you want to go, and then you hit another trigger, and then like you can wait a little while, and then he'll rearrange again. And so, like, if you walk carefully, you can always see where you go.
Yeah, and one of the funniest facts about the whole thing is there's no rails for Virgil. He actually just completely flies about the place, but it's so dark that you can't tell. And that hole in the floor is just me being completely cruel and making sure the player is actually paying attention to Virgil, because he does have a line where he tells the player to be careful once they reach that spot.
Yeah, and then, like, if you don't press this lever for a little while, you get different voice lines to encourage you to actually flip the lever.
And this is the end of chapter 4.
Yeah, like, the next level will be Corexus, but, like, for, like, 2 years in development, that was Finale 1. I think the actual finale we have now, like, I think only, like, started, like, a year ago, where we... Maybe less, even, I don't know. But, well, like, this section was built a lot earlier, and Stephen, like, drawn out the general layout, and then...
Yeah, I come with, like, basically my idea for a finale was, like, that you had to run around and do various tasks under, like, a sort of time pressure limit, and then we sort of... Like, Anna liked the idea of, like, going about the place to, and, like, completing various tasks, like, in order to reach the final boss, rather than actually sort of being, like, part of the actual finale. So this is sort of, like, a build-up to it, and what I designed, like, these three sections that you'd have to go to. So there's the generator, and then security, and then turret access. And I made this central hub here, which is obviously quite clearly based on the original, like walkway up to Gladys. Yeah. And it's also, like, partially based off, like, Magneto's prison and X-Men and stuff. And then each of these sections, then, was tackled by one of us. So this section, the generator part, was my section. And then Chris did the security section, and Anna did the turret section. Although you built some of the little stations here for the lab.
Yes. My experience in real live labs came in handy here.
You can put on the floor, you know, in there. And yeah, this room kind of came out pretty...
This is also really funny. Like, we wanted to show off the turrets, but the problem is that the turrets were slightly too big, so we actually cheat. And the turrets that fly through here are actually 80% of the normal size of the turrets, so they don't, like, so they actually fit inside the tubes.
And here's quite a Half-Life 2 inspired generator room. In fact, it's got the Half-Life 2 generators, although actually... Well, I think the Half-Life 2 used... or you made them, and then, like, they were redone again in Left 4 Dead to make them a bit higher quality or something.
Yeah, I think that these are from Left 4 Dead 2, yeah. Oh.
Yeah, I think the original version is in, like, Half-Life, but it looks awful.
Yeah, it's in the... in Ravenholm.
Yeah, and here we have, like... little things where, like, turrets shoot out glass and stuff if you walk in front of it. Although that one, this part is, like, completely and utterly cheated, because there's actually a trigger with a bullseye that forces the turrets to do it, whereas the other glass, the turrets are actually physically trying to shoot you.
Yeah, and, like, this is also, like, we when we were watching people play through, a lot of people had trouble, like, shooting the surface, so we've actually reduced the tube, the...
Yeah, I put like detailed, like, air ducts going through it, but then ended up just blocking your portal half the time, so, you know, sacrificed a bit of looking pretty for obviously gameplay reasons. And yeah, this sort of teaches you, it's like the beginning of teaching the importance that turrets can actually be useful to you when they shoot stuff.
Yeah.
And yeah, so you complete this section and then you're told to go back to Central Hub, and, like, it's sort of an interesting mechanic to have to backtrack, although to try to keep it interesting, this is why the red field activates, and this time you have to walk along the tubes, although you can do that the first time you come in anyway, but, you know, I try to keep it a bit different, like, you're coming back and, like, you've got that blocking you.
Yeah, and the idea is that, like, originally, like, the powers off and like the death shields aren't powered, and now you power up everything in order to get to the security room, but that means that like the death shields are active, like suddenly like there's a death field here.
Yeah, and of course the protect detector is active to show that the power is on.
Yeah.
Also, one thing we just briefly glanced over is the names of the labs in my section.
I can't go back.
But like, if you look, if I mentioned it's Lab 80 and Lab 8E, I put that in, and when I made them, I just thought it'd be funny if they had like some sort of rivalry, and they could never tell who was talking about what because they both just sound the same. And yes, this is Chris's section. It's kind of funny. In my original drawing of this level, I drew exactly this, and then. Rather than using it as inspiration, Chris literally made my drawing like exactly as if it was a top-down view of exactly what I wanted. So I always find that quite funny.
Yeah, and like over here, like there's a lot of cubes flying around, and the background looks really nice as well.
Yeah, this is like probably one of the biggest like BTS areas, more sort of Portal 2 style.
Yeah, this is really Portal 2 style.
One of the things to say is, though, that thank goodness you didn't follow my drawing, because I had no idea what to do for the turret factory. In fact, the turret factory originally had gels in it, because we wanted to sort of go through all the testing elements you'd used, and, well, I just basically did a bunch of squiggles for your section, so you didn't really have much to go on.
No, I had a fairly good idea what I wanted to do. I wanted to do the hidey behind server thing, which turned out to be a really bad idea, but I think at the end it turned out pretty nice.
Yeah.
And yeah, over here, like, we wanted you to interact with the test chambers, and like both of them, so we decided to like use this here to like pull you back through this test chamber.
But the one with the blue gel, I actually redesigned the interior of it to make it like look like an actual solvable puzzle, because originally it was just sort of like a big room.
I've seen a lot of players like try to solve this.
Yeah, so I'm not sure whether that was a good idea to have done that, but I tried to hint, because the indicator lights are grey, as in it's like powered down and stuff, and like there's no cube spawns, but like I thought it was a nicer touch that it looks like it's an actual solvable puzzle, and well, apparently it seems to have worked, because people are actually trying to solve it. And then, yeah, I made this little room because I thought it would be cool to have something that overlooks the bridge, and like, it seems like a suitable place for a security room, you know, that controls stuff.
Yeah, so you could see the field disabling, and that's also like...
Yeah. And again, when heading back, you don't take the same path back, like, we didn't want to be just having to walk all the way back again, it'd be really boring, so there's a nice handy shortcut here, which is, you know, pretty cool, you know, you can see exactly where you were and stuff like that. So it made designing these sections pretty challenging, because it's like you have to almost design it twice, like one for one way and one for going back, and like whether you make a shortcut and stuff, and like I think your section handled that very well.
Yeah, it like wraps around on itself. And this is I think one of the longest sections of dialogue in the mod.
Try not to trap you in rooms too much.
No, and because, like, you want to have something to do while Virgil is talking, we also have this amazing...
Yeah. I literally only added this thing because it was like, I'm bored and I really love this animation. Like, this is completely Valve's animation, completely ripped from their level, but it's such an amazing animation. I loved it so much. I was like, you know, people are probably going to get bored in this room, so I might as well give them something to look at. So this is just my little addition to this room. And it works. Like,
yeah, like, this is, it's really important to have this thing here, because it already starts explaining stuff for the finale.
Yeah, I mean, obviously Portal 2, a lot locks in a room with Wheatley Blab and plot critical details at you. And yes, this whole, there's a little window here, like, as well, this is all back from your original idea then?
No, the window was added later because, at some point the turrets were incredibly punishing, so you really, really had to see, like, what's coming. So, like I have a player thing here, so, like, I shouldn't shoot that. so I should wait, and like, this is a server, and I can hide behind this. But we found out that it felt really punishing for a lot of players, so we ended up like making this a lot easier. You can fairly safely just cross over here.
There's pretty much damage.
But like, if you do get shot, you can actually get shot and you can actually die.
Yeah, basically it was like, don't hide behind the test subject cutout, hide behind the server cutout. But yeah, kind of.
So turrets are a really tricky thing because they need some time to aim at you, and it's very tricky to make good puzzles where you like the turrets are really like they're finicky to work with, really.
Yeah, they've also got really fake blind spots because they could snipe you really badly, so that kind of reduced the difficulty in the end. We decided that the reduced difficulty was better than the original, which was completely very difficult. Like, if you weren't hugging the server model, you would never make it across.
And you have to like crouch completely, and we've seen a lot of people like almost panic here, like, oh, where do you have to go? And like, there's actually like a big wall over there with a flickering light and sparks that tries to draw your attention.
We couldn't really do much more apart from giant neon arrow being like, portal here, and people still miss it, but you know, they get there. And look, this is like the most plot convenient thing ever. But then again, like, portal games are always for plot convenience. So there just happens to be a handy cutout server of the Aegis servers, which it's not that like convenient because there are the cutouts that are moving along the shooting gallery ring, so they could have just came from there.
Oh. And like, over here, like, we wanted to signal, like, hey, the turrets are your friend now, so they all have this little, nice little green sprite on top of them, and there you're once again reinforced, like, just try and see what happens, see if you get shot now.
Yeah. Also, fun fact, originally the noise of these turrets shooting was so annoying, because all you would hear through the whole level was the turrets rattling and rattling and rattling, so it was actually other block losses that prevent the turrets from shooting at the start, and then once you reach the section, they'll start shooting, and then very quickly, like, they then get pretty much forced to stop shooting again, because it was so annoying.
Yeah, and, like, over here, there's also, like, block losses to prevent limit the amount of time that's required to shoot. And like over here, you now like visually can see like, hey, the mel mod or the player models stay alive and the servers get shot, so you now know that like these turrets, like the normal turrets, are your friends.
Yeah, I think most people would probably miss that detail that they actually do shoot the server cutouts now.
Yeah. But like,
and
that's,
here's the nice little loop back, which also is a very cool speedrun thing, because you can like do a weird thing with like portaling either side of the door, and then because of the way portals work, you can actually like hit the button behind the door and all this stuff. It's quite fun.
Yeah.
But yeah, so now, a cool idea Chris came up with was locking the areas to keep, because it was a bit more confusing before, like you could walk back and forth and then people might get lost, so each area only opens when it's needed and then closes again.
Yeah, like at this point you're completely stuck in this room, and so you're forced to once again go past these turrets, and now they're friendly, like now they don't shoot you anymore.
And this leads us on to the finale.
Yes.
And this was like, I think one of the first things you said to me when I joined the team, like, one of your ideas was that you always wanted the turrets to like shoot something on behalf of the player as part of a finale.
No. And like, the actual like way it turned out, it's taken some time, and Stephen came up with
Anna's original thing, while sounding cool on paper, whenever she got around to making it, was absolutely atrocious. It involved, like, what was it? You had 6 turrets would spawn, and then it would go down to 5 turrets, then 4, 3, 2, 1.
Yeah,
and you'd have to move all the turrets at once, and it was so crazy. Like, you could never do it, and, like, you had to move so fast before they blew up. It was just annoying.
Yeah, and, like, pretty much, like, the moment we finished, like, the very, very early prototype where, like, the servers actually turned into paper boxes for months. That was really, really funny. Instead of,
that's,
like,
just by the way, you kind of glossed over him.
Whoops. Yeah, but, like, the mechanics, like, we already, like, the turret shooting service was fun, but the way it was working was really bad, and, like...
Yeah. So, in fact, one of the funny things is, on the other side there of the room, the way that the turrets are laid out, or the servers, is exactly how I laid them out in my demo room. Basically, I just made it look fancier, but I got the idea from Portal 1, like, where the finale was based around really simple flings, and as Valve have already noted, that as soon as you give a bit of time pressure and some dramatic music, players will fail doing the simplest tasks. So, like, there's literally two really, really simple flings that you have to do, and that's it. And, like, people still struggle to solve it in 4 minutes, and it can be solved in about a minute and a half.
Yeah, and, like, we made sure that, like, there's margin for error. Like, you can pretty much, like, mess up two or three times, and you're still good to go.
Yeah, and so, I came up with, like, I think I still have the original, like, outline and, like, draft explanation and stuff for this. So I wanted a little training area first, as you know, as is normal with tutorialization of new elements, you know, train the player somewhere safe, in a safe environment, so that way they get to practice it, and then you know, bring them into the real thing. So here you see the turret, shoot the servers, then you're told, you know, you can pick it up and get it to shoot them, and you've got no time limit here, there's no pressure, you can take your time, you can practice, you know, setting the turret down and stuff, and like, this sort of trains the player up for what they're about to do in a safe environment.
Yeah, and like over here, indeed, like lost over that earlier, it's Aegis. And like, it's heavily inspired by Mother from Alien.
Yeah, well, there's like an interior thing, which is like obviously inspired by like Mother from Alien. And then like the exterior design is a spider. And it kind of just happened to tie into the fact that I made the Aegis logo be the letter A surrounded by an octagon, which if you notice, if you look at the glass and the walls and stuff, the entire chamber is an octagon as well, and it sort of fits in with the 8 and the spider motif and stuff.
Yeah.
And a funny fact, if it can be called funny, I'm so bad at Photoshop that the A logo that I made is actually the letter I, just repeated over and over into the shape of an octagon, because I couldn't get a good octagon that was all rusted, whereas the text I was using was already like partially rusted. I probably should have got Jake to redo me a new one, but
it worked. And like the part, like the particles and like the sprites on the servers was absolutely like really well done. That's Tomas's work.
Yeah, Tomas did the explosions of the servers and stuff. Like, as you can see, like the tape, like real stuff was actually on top of the player's head because it collides with the world and stuff, and you can get covered in it. And again, like we sort of bring up a lot of elements that I already taught the player. Like there's electric water, and there's you know water puts out the fire again. I mean, this is only so you can get back. But it turns out you don't actually need to do this step anymore because you can just jump your way back. But at least it's there, just stuff you've learned.
Yeah. And like we have all kinds of different variations of the servers, and I'm really really happy with how this turned out. And then as soon as we get over here on the other side, the actual timer will start, and the real finale will begin. So
also for the server sort of idea, like that was based off Arnim Zola or whatever his name is from Captain America the Winter Soldier, so because he was like a computer like kept alive and like server and stuff and like the cameras on the head and stuff. But yeah, so now you have to do the exact same thing but with time pressure, so hopefully the little practice you got was like enough to train you up and then you get through this bit.
Yeah, which... like over here you already like see the old aperture turrets, and well, you've reprogrammed the new aperture turrets, and like the dialogue tells you as well, like, hey, these are your friends, but the old turrets aren't.
Yeah.
And it's actually really funny, because our mod is standalone, we had to like manually copy over all the stuff for all the stuff that's in Portal 2 that we use, and well, not manually, we scripted a bunch of it too, but a few moments, like all the you see some metal gibs fall off the server when they blow up, and like they would literally spam the entire screen with big fat blue error signs. It was really funny.
Also, to note, when you picked up that turret there, it blows up and blows the glass with it, which is very important because there's a portal surface beneath it, and again, with contrived coincidences in the portal universe, like just like every portal surface just happens to be painted exactly where you need it. But yeah, so this allows you to do a little fling and stuff, and again, this is like the whole like Portal 1 style thing, where like you've got the bottom row, which is just simple, then you can go upstairs, and that's sort of like phase 2, and then you do this little fling here, and that's phase 3, and that's it. That's the height of the, if you can call it a puzzle. But yet, like, people still seem to struggle to do this, like, within the 4 minutes. So, as a, like, heavy inspiration then from the Portal 1 boss battle. But I wondered this, like, with all the explosions and stuff, like, we hope it's a very sort of, like, it's a good payoff that you get to see all this stuff blow up, because explosions are fun.
And you see that, like, I still had 2 minutes to spare.
And that's even with going slow with me asking to look at stuff.
Yeah. So, like, it's very well possible in time, but, like, we wanted margin for error.
Also, I top-lit. Like, originally when you come in, it just is underlit to give it a sort of creepy vibe, and there's actually a red light comes on during the timer. Then I top-lit him to highlight the fact that you can land on him a bit better, and then there's a voice line that clearly states that you need to fling, and then these surfaces up there are actually incredibly cheated, like the lighting on them, like there's actually just massive fake lights making them as bright as humanly possible because we wanted to make sure players wouldn't miss them.
Yeah, and like there's like when you have to fling to that part, it's already like stated you have to fling there, and then once again you
fling. There's only really
it's...
one. Yeah, this is like the only place where you can fling from. And then this is a sort of training. But yes, and that is it.
That is it indeed. I'm scared to press E.
Oh yeah, the final button.
It has a really
very funny name if you
look
at it.
You should totally decompile the map and see the name of the trigger. It's really funny. And
yeah, so...
here we go into the SFM stuff, the cutscenes done by Harry.
What's funny to note is the interior in here might look bigger than the exterior, but it actually does fit perfectly inside purely by accident. There's a lot of nice details. There's a little mini companion cube, and there's the red phone from Gladys's chamber with the wire cut. And again, all of this is very, very heavily inspired by the computer Mother from Alien. It's got the same actual sound effects, I think, but Harry like re-edited them and tweaked them and stuff like that, so it's got the very sort of guttural kind of noises and sort of flashes and flickers and stuff.
Yeah, like pretty much like this entire screen and like everything that flickers and stuff is like full of little Easter eggs, and like in the bottom here, I can't show it with my mouse, but in the bottom of the screen,
scrolling text is the compile log for factory. Like if you've ever compiled a map, it's right aligned rather than normal left aligned. But right here, you can actually see VRAD because you can see the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 that it does for the lighting. So that's just another pretty fun fact.
Yeah.
And also, it's version 101 because Harry Callaghan, like Harry 101 UK, was the voice actor for ages. But yeah, every time there's a little flicker on the screen and like words pop up for a fraction of a second, they're all like just really random funny jokes that we stuck in.
Yeah, like in the main menu you saw like delete system 32, release third Steam Valve, and all that kind of funny jokes, and like downloading RAM and that kind of stuff.
Yeah, so big spoilers, I just was trying to stop Gladys, and you kind of put a spanner in those works.
Whoops.
Originally, Mel did have a surname, but Anna, you decided against it. We decided to just go with the usual redacted, just because, you know, we kind of like a bit of the mystery, and we didn't really want to give her a surname. In fact, I think she had a full name too, rather than just being Mel.
Yeah,
it was
like
Melinda
Melissa
or something.
Yeah,
it
I'm not
Melinda.
Sure. Yeah.
Like so we're just like, we'll just stick with Mel.
Yeah.
And I hate this joke, like I hate this whole part of this now, because like the whole 25th thing was like, I don't know if I mentioned earlier, it was like a joke like putting that in the levels and then everyone sort of snuck them in, and it was meant to be like a sort of Bad Wolf reference from Doctor Who with like a repeating message, but then like I think it got taken like just a step too far, like just for this, but just it's just the shutdown code for ages. But it sort of it seems like a dramatic moment that it's
yeah, it's just like, you know, the scientists had to remember that number. Like, if anything goes wrong, 2056, and like just painted it all over the walls.
Yeah, there's actually a secret little area with like Ratman art with like 2056 and says make it stop, which is obviously implying A, to the fact that I'm sick of seeing 2056 everywhere, so I want to make that stop, and also B, it makes ages stop. So, double meaning there.
Yeah, and it's really funny, a few seconds back you saw the animation where the gun got put down, and there's the reverse animation, like the pickup animation, but reversed.
Yeah, bye-bye gun.
Oh, and bye-bye Virgil.
Yeah, Harry did a great job animating Virgil here. And there's, like, very subtle details. Like, there's actually a little soft glow on his eye that he had to manually track onto a Virgil.
Yeah, and I think that Stieg also did an outstanding job with the voice acting.
Yeah. And a nice little subtle touch I got Harry to add in is, well, two things, actually. When the lift comes down, Harry put in the portal one, doo-doo-doo, like, elevator noise, which I thought was a lovely touch. So I made sure that he kept that. But I got him to add in a little thing that, as you leave here, Virgil looks up and you look down just in the brief second before.
Like, no!
And yes, so this whole part, like, this level, because obviously these SFMs are actual, like, levels. And then Harry goes in and lights them and stuff and maybe takes a few extra props because he has access to more, is made by me, and there's a little Maze Runner reference there with the number on the wall, which is actually the escape code to the maze. But yeah, so I sort of built this.
This is two of a kind, by the way.
Yeah. Well, this is an homage, obviously, to the end of Portal 2 where you go up on a lift and see all the destroyed stuff. So it's sort of like a cross-section, like you've got the sort of still functional, like, panel-y area, and then this is sort of older area that's closer to the surface. And then you have the final little exit room, and again, another little Maze Runner joke with the exit sign. Like, after all this, there's just a door with a sign that says exit on it. Like, kind of anticlimactic.
Yeah, and then you then go to, like, the most amazing shot ever, like...
Yeah, this was a lot of work and incredibly fun. I just took the town map, and then... absolutely destroyed it more than I've ever destroyed anything in this entire game. And like, this is the biggest map I've ever made in Hammer, and it was so big it kept crashing both Hammer and Source Filmmaker, and I had to keep trimming it down. And it's heavily inspired by Midgar, and it was because of the fact that Aperture always build on top of their stuff, and obviously the exterior of the maze from the Maze Runner as well, so very heavy influences there.
Yeah, and like, this took days 48
hours of rendering for a 40-second shot. And like, it took me about a week, I think, to make the map and get it trimmed down enough that SFM wouldn't crash instantly. And also, we tried to whenever we compiled it, we had to compile it without visibility, because even though there was no vis leaves at all, like, Source does not like large-scale open areas, and it took 3 hours, and it still crashed in the end.
And these are the credits. This is my incredibly creepy face. We were all drawn, like, this is how you look when the mod releases, and like,
and this is
it's
me.
Yeah, that's Steven.
So that's Chris. I made like most of these areas. I didn't make your area. I didn't make Chris's, and I didn't make Harry's, but I made the rest of these areas, and it was my idea. Just, I thought it'd be really cool to like see each of our like faces, like for the main, like the core development team. So Jake did an absolutely wonderful job, and like, we had to send pictures of us looking like really bedraggled and tired as like as much as possible, so that we would look really creepy for the Ratman style. And then like, I made a room for each of us and tried to make it sort of unique and also sort of somewhat resembling to what we've did.
And then we have the rest of the credits rolling.
Yeah.
Well, the other people that have helped us out with the mod. That's,
yeah, there's been a hell of a lot of people.
Yeah. It's
who all did awesome work.
Yeah, and after we've gone through this, we will go to the after credits. So yeah. Keep watching.
And the funny thing about the after credits is, like, I made that map so long ago. In fact, so long ago that part of the after credits is actually in the trailer. For those with a keen eye, you'll actually spot part of the after credits in it, because Harry had already did part of the SFM for it. But again, as I'd already did an homage to Portal 2's lift, I had to do an homage to Portal 1 where you did the zoom down. So this was a very quick map to make, actually. So, and it was very fun. And like, it's just a quick little zoom down. You see bits of aperture. And then I really want to do that really cool glowy hallway and how you did a great job lighting that and stuff. And zooming through some air ducts.
And this is the part where you completely disorientated.
Yeah, because like, it wasn't really disorientating enough, like the Portal 1 one was, so we had to stick that in. And then you come in, and this was my part of the story that I added on to the end, because originally it just sort of didn't really have an end. Like, I sort of came up with this ending, and like, I kind of wanted to tie it together with Portal 2, and like, I based off a line that Wheatley says, and the Lab Rat comics, and the Lab Rat comics, as you can see, like, he puts Chell, the B-test subject 001, like, he moves her up the list. And then in Portal 2 itself, Wheatley mentions that the reserve power ran out and it started waking up all the bloody test subjects. So that's why I did like the reserve power running out, because like, it seems like the best thing to do to make sure Gladys wouldn't come back online, like get rid of the reserve power. Plus that, you know, kind of explains why all the cubes and stuff have stopped flying through the vents and everything sort of shuts down again. So I think it fits in, but, you know, I'm sure some people might disagree with me, but I did my best. I wanted to sort of tie it in, and then there's the whole like the first voice line of Portal 2 plays with the not the really the first one, because there's the 50 days one, but that would be like pre-Mel waking up, that would be like just after Portal 1, but this is like the first proper line of Portal 2 starting.
And here we're back to the main menu where you see the destroyed town, and time again plays once again Gray's song written by Ian, and this once again like ties back to the beginning of the mod where this song also plays and you have the town, and I think overall it wraps up really nicely.
Nice bookends. And like one of the, I really, really loved this Aperture logo, like the modern Aperture Laboratories logo. And I was really disappointed when I found it in the model files because I realized that it was never actually used in Portal 2, like to my knowledge, I've never found it. So I wanted to make sure that it got used and it gets a nice highlight here, along with the juxtaposition of the old Aperture monument that Harry
That's the mod.
What's your like post-release feelings and breakdown then, like how do you feel?
I'm really happy with the mod. I've seen a lot of positive comments and I had an absolute blast both making the mod and watching people play the mod. I've been lurking around in a lot of Twitch streams, I've seen a lot of YouTube videos, and
the speedruns, I think, have been absolutely amazing. I mean, like I said, we've did our best to not interfere. Unfortunately, we've had to change a few things to upset speedrunners because some of the things were like had to be fixed because they were like either game breaking or just like really stupid. But we did our best to keep a lot of stuff in. And in fact, I actually added skips in for the lift and the tram ride so they could like bunny hop down the tram ride and stuff and make that a bit more fun for speedrunners, because like we really do love the stuff that they do. And like, I'd say I'm very proud of like my, I mean, obviously in hindsight, like every mistake that you made is like magnified by 1,000, and like, you know, there's things that could possibly have been done better,
like, yeah, maybe, but like at some point you also want to like,
yeah, eventually you have to call
at some point you have to stop improving and actually release it. Like you can always improve upon things.
Yeah, because like you could spend forever polishing and polishing and polishing and polishing, and then eventually like the benefit that you get from it isn't really like worth it. But in terms of difficulty, obviously it's been a very sort of contentious issue. Like a lot of people do like the difficulty because they like the challenge and they've been wanting a challenge, and like some people feel the greater the challenge, the greater the reward. Like wow, I solved it. Like this is amazing. Like I did really well. But then there's other people who don't like that because they just find it frustrating. Like they prefer sort of a quicker, like easier sort of puzzle.
Yeah, and, like, but I think that like we've always intended to challenge players, and I've played through a lot of Portal 1 and Portal 2 mods, and they all start off with training things you already know.
Yeah, like the whole putting a cube on a button thing, if I see that one more time in a mod, I'm going to cry, because like every single person knows how to do that. I mean, also one of the sort of factors was like, why would you play our mod if you'd never played Portal 1 and 2? Like, you're clearly probably going to have played both of them first.
Well, you have to own Portal 2 anyway, so like, and like, pretty much every review or mention of the mod has been like, it's hard, so like, Yeah, it's generally.
Although that's not always like.
Not always a bad thing, no. But
yeah, it's not always mentioned as a negative thing. But like, you know, it's been quite. It's probably been the most. I mean, every single thing in the mod has been divisive on whether people liked it or not. But I think the difficulty's been one of the biggest things. Like I said, like a lot of people do like it. Like, so you know, I don't know. Like.
I think we can be proud of the mod.
Yeah, definitely. Like, I'm very happy with what we've come up with in the end. I mean. It was a lot of work, and at some point, especially coming up to the end, like, it was extremely, extremely stressful, like, yeah. More so than we ever could have imagined, and it was not fun at all, and, like, as Anna said, like, you have to push past it and, like, eventually just accept, like, you know, this is good enough to go.
Yeah, and like, yeah, you know, we're really happy with how it turned out, and let us know in the comments what you think of the mod. And I hope you found our developer commentary on the mod interesting. So yeah, thanks for watching, thanks for playing the mod. Let us know what you think, and yeah, bye.
Yep, thank you very much.